Call the meeting to order. Please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Call for the acceptance of the minutes of the October 8th, 2024 meeting. Been moved in. Seconded. Discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? No one. Motion carries. Public forum for this evening. No one? Just want to make sure that they saw. You're good? No one? All right. All right, we'll move on to presentations for this evening. Call up to the podium, Superintendent Wiles, Vince Napoli, Capital Project.
Good evening, everybody. So this evening, as we promised the last meeting, we're going to be sharing some information regarding the upcoming capital improvement project referendum that will go before the public on Tuesday, December 3rd. So we're going to go through some slides. I just want to point out a couple of other dates. On election night, November 5th, we are going to be doing tours. We've gotten some requests from the community to see the improvements that have been made already over the years with regard to the current capital project we're in and previous capital projects. So we'll be doing tours on November 5th at 5 o'clock, 6 o'clock, and 7 o'clock. So our parents and the community can come in and tour the building, see some of the changes, and really note maybe what some of the upcoming changes are going to be. We'll be putting out some information on our website and also on Facebook for links to sign up for those. We get an idea of how many people are coming on those evenings. So that'll be November 5th. On November 7th, we will be providing another presentation on the capital project for anybody in the community that would like to come. And as we get more questions, we're putting together a Q&A. You can find that on our website as we get them, www.ecs.k12.ny.us. When you get to the website, the first top of the website, not the title pages, but it says information here about capital projects. We'll be updating that over the next couple of months so that you could see what's coming. So I'm going to start, and I want to talk about this project, which is themed success, safety, and sports. We're going to start by talking about what our priorities were when we put this project together. So we want to increase the health, safety, and security in our buildings. We want to enhance our athletic fields, provide an outdoor education space at the elementary school. We're talking about that space being right outside of the new library that we have, and having an outdoor classroom and an outdoor space. And if people do choose to come and do the tour, and you look at our new library, it's very impressive. When we had the Hall of Fame tour, when we've had alumni come in, it's just there's new impressive space down in the elementary school. And we're going to be adding to that. We address the highest priority of infrastructure updates that were identified in the latest building condition survey. If you hear BCS, that's what we're referring to. We're going to continue to work on improving energy efficiency, complying with the with fire regulations, safety regulations, American with Disabilities Act, and other required building codes. So what are going to be the safety, security, compliance upgrades? So the first thing we're going to do, and I have a few pictures we're going to go through, we're going to be replacing the 1980s era public announcement system and phone systems to ensure functionality and improve safety in emergencies. So the current PA system we have and the current phone system we have are very antiquated. Everything's moving to digital, voice over the internet, phone systems, and we've been to other districts. We visited Minisink and saw really a state-of-the-art PA system and phone system that really helps with the safety and security in the buildings also. We're going to continue to replace aged doors, interior and exterior, and the hardware to meet current safety, security, and fire rating standards. So I just want to make a comment about some of this work, because you might go back to the last project and say, oh, they did this. They're just asking for more money to, you know, we budgeted for this. What happened to all that money? Well, we did budget for windows and doors. And we had that project approved in 2019. So let's think about, you know, the 5 years that's passed, 6 years by the time we get to this. We've seen inflation. We've seen materials not being accessible for construction projects that have really skyrocketed the prices. So things that we had budgeted for came out double, sometimes triple, so we had to scale back. But the windows still need to be replaced. Doors still need to be replaced. When we do the tour and you look at the new doors in the elementary school and you have the opportunity to see them, we have just about all the doors in the elementary school done. But now we want to work on the 712 building so we can upgrade the doors and the hardware in those buildings. We also have to replace aged water service original to the junior senior high school building from the village of Ellenville. So we're responsible for the water connections from our building to the village infrastructure. And we know that we have not done any work on that probably in 50, 60 years. We know that those pipes are definitely, even though they're steel and they are made of other material, they rust over periods of time, and we want to be proactive taking care of that before we have a break in a water main and we have to rip everything up. So in addition to that, we're going to continue to look at our ventilation and air exhaust systems in identified areas for air quality improvement. We're pretty lucky with the ESSA funds that we got, or the ARP funds we got from the COVID relief. We used a lot of those funds to upgrade our HVAC. We need to continue to do that. So I just want to say, when people say, well, they did that already, you know, this is a huge building. It's a huge house. I'm going to just put that in perspective. And you know, for homes or for commercial properties, it's never ending to upgrade and fix. So it's really important that we stay ahead of that, so we're really being less reactive and more proactive in what our how we're taking care of the building. And I'm going to digress a little bit. Why now? Why this project? You know, we might have other priorities. Why are we not focusing on academics? And I just want to be clear, we are focusing on academics. The board's been very purposeful about adding supports, and we will always do that. But we cannot allow the facility that the kids come to school in and learn here for, you know, 6-7 hours a day or participate in extracurricular activities fail. So it's important that we take a balanced approach and we continue to look at this building and the envelope of the building, the interior of the building, and not only the building, the athletic facilities that I'm going to talk about in a few minutes. And we're also going to be upgrading and installing handrails and emergency lighting to meet ADA and code requirements. So this is a picture of the public address and phone system. We've moved this system around a few times, and every time you move it, it's really old. And we've had some issues with the PA and the phone system during the last capital project, and we're on our last legs with it, right? So you're going to hear that a lot. We're on our last legs with it. This has to be done. And we'll talk about show more of the cost of this, but this is not just those panels. It's new wiring to every classroom in the whole district into different areas. We're going to make sure that the gyms and the outside facilities have PA systems that you can hear and have them measured. So that's a picture of that. Indoor, old doors with large glass windows that can't be secured against intruders. If you take a look at the new doors we put in the elementary school, they're heavy doors, and there are thin windows. You still can see in, but you don't have all of this glass where the whole class is exposed. And we are going to upgrade them so they're up to the fire rating standards. exterior doors. If you go through the building and you take a look at exterior doors, there are doors that are very old. We've been replacing them. We have replaced a few, but there's still many others that need to be done. The remaining aged, inefficient windows. So we have, I'm not sure, this is the elementary school? So this is the elementary school. We have some windows that we're picking and choosing in this project to be done, but we're not going to hit all of those windows that we were going to. So we're going to really need to prioritize in this project for next summer, and then move into hopefully the next project and continue the window replacement. Infrastructure. So we're going to continue to replace, rebuild, and look at the missing or deteriorated bricks and the masonry work on the building. And we started doing that. We have some additional work that'll be done this summer, but there's so much brick in this building that if you look at it, we say the bricks have to be pointed. The cement around the bricks, the mortar around the bricks is deteriorated, and we have to take care of that. We plan on replacing 7 end-of-life electrical panels in the junior senior high to provide increased capacity and improve service delivery. We did this about 10 years ago. The more technology and the more, you know, devices that we use, the more draw we have on the electrical capacity that has to be replaced. We're also going to be replacing the original folding doors and the partitions in the gymnasiums and in the senior high cafeteria. So we have these folding doors. We took care of the classrooms. Oh, I'm talking into the mic. That's why Vince is here, to make sure I talk into the mic. We have replaced some of the folding partitions in the classrooms, but we'll be replacing the ones in the gymnasiums and the senior high cafeteria. So here are some pictures. This is just an example of the concrete and masonry crumbling. The picture on the top left, we're hoping to get this done this summer, but there's other work around that needs to be done also. This is a good example of the brickwork that has to be replaced. And these are the old damaged folding partitions in the gymnasiums, both elementary, junior, senior high, and also the senior high cafeteria. Physical education, athletic field, and outdoor learning spaces. So I just want to preface this by saying, you know, we've been having these discussions about our athletic facilities, about our physical education facility, where kids go out and they participate in PE during the school day, and also participating in extra in our sports, and what those facilities look like. So I just want to say respectfully, this is not a project to make everything look better. This is a project to really replace some aged infrastructure, and I'm going to show you some pictures that we have from a drone that'll show you what the condition is looking from the sky down on the field. So the plan here, if it's approved, is to reconstruct the existing six-lane track to an 8-lane track, all-weather track. Relocate the discus, shot put, and jumping field events. Replace natural grass athletic field with an all-weather artificial turf lined for football, soccer, and field hockey. Install new grandstand bleachers with seating for 800 spectators, including a new integrated press box. Upgraded aged field lights for track, football, and soccer with energy-efficient, brighter LED models to improve lighting. We'll also are more efficient with regard to electricity use. Replace the aged football scoreboard. Improve baseball and softball fields, including new backstops, dugouts, bullpens, batting tunnels, scoreboards, and bleachers. So I'm going to stop there. Some of you might remember that this is included in the existing project, some of the work on the fields. It is not to the depth that we want to see on our fields. And if you have been out to a baseball game or a softball game in the back of the school, you can see what the conditions of the fields are, and I'm going to show you that. in a moment. Rehabilitate the natural grass soccer and field hockey, the existing fields, to improve playing surfaces, address drainage issues, and provide for proper orientation to the sun. So you might say, why are they going to do that if they're doing a turf field, right? We want to try to keep as much as we can here, but we still need practice fields. Remember, we still have modified teams that play, and those fields have to be brought up to, you know, a better condition. In addition, as I said earlier, we're going to construct an outdoor education space in the elementary school. We're going to expand the existing weight room into a fitness center, increasing occupancy and providing additional cardio equipment. We are planning on partnering with the town, I'm going to talk about this at length here in a minute, to relocate the pool house to the shallow end of the pool complex and expand it for dual use as community restrooms, concessions, multi-purpose facility down there. So the plan for this, you can envision the old pool house, which is on its last legs, and if you're looking from the building down to the pool, it's on the right side. A new facility would be built on the left side of the pool, and that would double for a concession stand for during the school year, bathrooms for during the school year and in the summertime, and the town would be able to use it to have students change in changing rooms for their summer program, right? So it's going to be a multi-purpose building. Recently, the town of Warsaw received a swims grant from DASNY. And if I remember correctly, it was for about It's more than that
That's
now.
That's the DASNY part.
It's about $4.7 million with the town's contribution. You know, their contribution they have to make. We're in the process of working with the town to request additional funding from DASNY to see if any additional funding is available for them to probably or to work on leveraging additional funds to go towards the building. If that happens, right, and there are rules and we have to make sure we're following all of their rules, we might be able to repurpose some of the money that we have budgeted for that pool house for other improvements or additional improvements that we have. So we are working probably weekly with the town, trying to see how they could leverage the money, but they have money to fix the pool. The pool needs to be fixed. We've been talking to a couple of companies. I actually was at a conference the last couple of days, and I spoke to a company that puts pool liners in. Lot of new technology that could be paid for with that grant, kind of very exciting. I also spoke to a company that has done the turf fields for both Rondout and Pine Bush, and they are actually on a pseudo state contract, so we will be able to utilize a vendor that we that has some experience in doing this and doing it well. In addition to that, if you go out into the back of the building now, picture for graduation, or you're walking down to a baseball game, we plan on adding paved walkways to connect the athletic fields and to make them ADA accessible, right? So if someone's here with a wheelchair, you don't have to walk on, or you're walking, you aren't going to walk on uneven, you know, ground, and that will connect all of those areas to the restrooms that we plan on putting in the that multi-purpose building. And we also are constructing a new 1,500 square foot building for physical education and athletic equipment and other district storage use. I'm going to show you an overview on where we're going to put that. So this is the proposed fitness center. It does take part of it does take the existing room and expands it into the existing music room we have now. We'll be relocating the music room. And these are some schematics that draft that we have. And these will be on the website. We also have them on what a fitness center could look like after we go through the design process, or will look like. OK, Okay, this is a big point of contention for everybody, right? So we have this existing press box concession stand. It's the tower, and it is very old and antiquated, and it's on its last legs. So this would be replaced. These would be replaced. First, like the bottom part of the press box would go into the multi-purpose building by the pool. The top part of it would go behind new bleachers in a real press box that you would see at other schools. So these are our existing fields. When you look at them, you could see the track. You can see the area right by the baseball field, and you can see how the field over periods of time have eroded, right? And to fix them, we're really going to have to dig them up and relay them out, and that's the plan here. This is from a drone. This is the existing field hockey field. You can see it needs work. All of this will be relayed out, and this is what the composite athletic fields will look like. So I'm just going to take this so I can point to it. I don't know if everyone can see this at home. So you have, just for a point of reference, and we didn't get this fixed. We don't have a middle school. We have a junior high school, the elementary. This is the back of the building. You have the new artificial turf, new 8-lane. You can track along and see where the new walkways are. You can see how the fields and the baseball and softball fields have been turned a little bit. And this slide will show you exactly what I talked about with regard to all of this. We are also looking at if we can squeeze a little bit more money out of the referendum to put a lot more lighting in the back, because during athletic events and even in the evenings when people come to the back of the school, whether it to be, you know, for whatever event, a football event, it's pretty dark between the athletic fields and the buildings. So we're looking at that. Baseball and softball, the fields will be improved, but we'll also have new backstops, dugouts, bullpens, batting tunnels, scoreboards, and bleachers. The district will be able to host invitationals once the existing six-lane track is expanded to 8. So why turf? So I got this question was asked of me at the PTO meeting. So there was a parent, justifiably so, asking about turf. And then many years ago, there were some studies that connected them, turf fields, to childhood diseases and cancer and all that. And we are providing the research. There'll be links on on our website. The materials that are used for artificial turf have come a very, very long way. And more than ever, the research indicates that they are safer than they were when they first came out. So why do we want to use turf? It's long-term maintenance costs. Lining, seeding, fertilizing, mowing are reduced. There is a maintenance cost about 8 to 10 years out, which we have already with our track, where you'll have to do some work on that. But since scheduled maintenance is minimal, the availability for student use is increased. So think about it. Right now, we don't utilize the football field as much as we could, because football is like, you know, with the cleats, it's a lot of wear and tear. If we run soccer games out there or field hockey games, it really does impact the quality of the field. But with turf, more games can be played out there with less maintenance. Artificial turf is more durable than natural grass. Again, eliminating the need for the field to rest between practices and competitions. The need for cancellations due to weather-related field conditions is reduced. Teams can practice on the same type of surface they compete on at other schools in the league. And I'm going to pause here because I think this is important. Our students go to other schools like Rondout, Highland. They'll see a huge change. Spack and Kill, Liberty, those schools have upgraded their facilities. And when you go to those facilities and then you come back to our facilities, there's a significant difference. And I'm going to use this as an example. We put a new cafeteria in the elementary school and a new library. if this passes, we'll have new athletic fields. The access, right, that our students have to those facilities. I look at the cafeteria and I can't believe we went so long in the old cafeteria we have. Now when we look at the facility that the kids eat in or the kids study in the library, it's the same thing. Why shouldn't our students have, just saying, got to ask ourselves, do we want our students to have the same, you know, experience that other schools have? So we want our students to come back here and be able to practice and have access to the same fields that other schools have. The soft, smooth surface does not deteriorate during gameplay, eliminating ruts and divots that can trip athletes. There's no need for pesticides or fertilizers or for gasoline-powered mowers, which can reduce carbon emissions. Artificial turf does not require watering, and Ellenville will have the opportunity to host sectional and regional competitions. Shift over to the community pool house. Pool house is on its last legs, we know that. And while we don't use this pool house, we lease it to the town for the use of the pool and the recreation program, we could use that if it was placed differently as a multi-purpose room for concessions and bathrooms so that we don't have to have porta potties at our games out back. This is what the inside of the building looks like. It's very deteriorated and it needs to be fixed, as does the steps. We've been putting Band-Aids on this building for the last 15 to 20 years. What's the funding plan? So the project, the capital project we're putting before the public is $22.3 million. And we have $2.5 million set aside in a capital reserve that'll offset those costs. We're hoping that the town will be able to offset the costs a little bit more, but we don't know for sure, so we did not count that in, but we're hoping we will be able to do that. The new building aid, New York State building aid to cover the project is about 41.7%. This will be financed over 15 years. That results in a 3.84% tax increase. But I want to be clear, that's not all at one shot. What we do when we have capital projects is we often take out a bond anticipation note, we start the work, and we bond later on. And as we do that, we borrow money, we pay some interest on it, but we get aid back on the interest also. And we slowly, over a period of 2 to 3 years, ease in the tax increase with regard to that. So it's not going to be 3.84 one particular year. It's going to be eased in over a period of a few years. And bond payments have to continue for 15 years. That's state required now that your bond goes out. So a bond in a school is like a mortgage on a house, right? You can have a 10-year mortgage, 15-year mortgage. We're not allowed to have 30-year mortgages because by the time you get to 30 years, you need to have projects in between. What does it mean to the taxpayers? So in Rochester, if you have a home that's assessed, not market value, assessed at $100,000, that means for the year on that assessed valuation, you will pay $108.20 for the year. That's at the 3.84%. This is in Rochester. That will be about $9 a month. In Mamikating, and this differs because of equalization rates and apportionment rules. We don't make this. This is what the state tells us. And I do have to say, this is based on assessed valuation today. That's all we can do is look at what our numbers are today. Mamikating, it'll be $174.32, which comes out to about $14.53 a year. And in Warsing, a house assessed at $100,000 would be an $89.65 increase for the year, or $7.47 a month. So again, I just want to caution everyone, this is based on this year's assessed valuation and equalization rates. That definitely can change, will change, changes every year, but this is the best we have right now for the predictions. So what does it mean to vote? What's the eligibility? To be eligible to vote, you have to be a registered voter in the Allenville Central School District, just like the budget vote. You have to be at least 18 years old, a U.S. citizen, a district resident for at least 30 days before the election. The new voter registration deadline is Tuesday, November 26th, and you can register at the central office with the district clerk Monday to Friday, 8:30 to 4:30 p.m. In-person voting will be here by paper ballot on Tuesday, December 3rd, 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. You can also vote by absentee and mail-in ballots. There's a new process in place in our state to do early voting ballots where you can, it's not just absentee ballots, you can cast your vote earlier, come get an application, fill out the application, turn the application in, get the ballot, and you can vote prior to that vote, and your a ballot that's filled out will be held and opened the night of the third when the polls closed. It's really important to tell you that if you're going to vote absentee or by a mail-in ballot, you have to have original signatures on the application, so it can't be faxed. You have to sign it and get it to us, and you can return it to us by mail, or you can walk in with the application and we'll give you your ballot. Or you can even ask someone to pick up your ballot for you and authorize them on the application to pick up the ballot, bring you the ballot, and you can either mail it or you can give it to the person to return it. The ballot deadline's November 3rd is the first day to submit completed ballot applications. So you can get an application now, but you can't submit the application till November 3rd to get the ballot. November 26th, application deadline to receive the ballot by the mail. So since the vote is the 3rd, we can't accept any more applications after the 26th of November. December 2nd is the application deadline to pick up the ballot in person. That is the day before the vote. And December 5th is the deadline, the day of the vote is the deadline for returning completed ballots. If you want to learn more about the project, www.ecs.k12.ny.us, right on the front, you'll see Capital Project 2024. Any questions you have that you'd like answered, you can email capitalproject@ecs, again, .k12.ny.us, or feel free to call Vince Napoli. His phone number is 845-647-0115. For any questions you can think of, and we're taking the questions and we'll be including the questions on a Q&A document so that people can see what they are. That's the end of my presentations. Any questions that anyone might have?
Thank you very much, Superintendent and Vince. We'll move on to reports, information, and correspondence. For myself, I have nothing. Board membership. No one. Student. Hey, we see Jack Henry's back with us. Jack, how's the world?
It's the world.
All right. What do you got?
All right. So, for the happenings and events going on, all schools in the district have been participating in the Red Ribbon Week to help prevent the use of drugs. Tomorrow, the college fair will take place in the high school gym for all students grades 7 to 12. On Saturday, the student council will sponsor their annual Think Pink Cancer Walk at 9 a.m. The registration is at 8:30 in the morning. First come, first serve. Tuesday, the 5th election day, the senior class will sponsor the spaghetti supper at 5 p.m. in the cafeteria. On November 6th, the senior high band and choir will perform in the autumn concert. For the athletics, the varsity football team has a game on Saturday in Onciora. A win will clinch a home playoff game. The cross country team will have their M-Hall championships on the 31st at the Hudson Valley Sports Dome in Milton. Both the varsity soccer teams, boys and girls, hosted their senior nights last week. The girls won 2-0 and the boys fell short 3-1 to Highland. For fundraisers, the class of 2026 finished their Gertrude Hawk fundraiser yesterday, and the pancake breakfast at the Elks Lodge will be on Sunday. The class of 2027 completed their holiday catalog on Friday. The Spanish Honor Society will be selling Dysing's Bakery Pies, and The Blue Devils merchandise sale is underway. You can buy shirts, hats, and more using the link tinyurl.com/ECSDmerch, or you can use the QR code.
Thank you very much. It's good to have you back, Jay. We'll move on to Superintendent Lisa Wiles.
I just have one clarification. One of the slides I put up said December 5th, and it's December 3rd. The vote is Tuesday, December 3rd, and I apologize for that, and we will correct it. But it's December 3rd. That's all I have tonight.
Assistant Superintendent for Business, Mr. Napoli.
I have nothing to report.
Deputy Superintendent, go ahead.
In our packet is the report about the cafeteria, and I was delighted to read it. It's really apparently doing a wonderful job down there, and it's not only the food; it's the people involved. That they're really creating an environment that's very welcoming, and their menu looks terrific. So I was really glad to read that. Thank you.
I'll share that with Debbie Fisher.
Please, thank you.
Danny.
I do have a question regarding the cafeteria. Is there anywhere on our school website where parents can see what the food that's being offered, where the ingredients are, and caloric content?
I will track that down for you, but Whitson's does provide all of the details for all the food that we're serving. One of the conversations that I did have with the regional director, as well as in conjunction with Debbie, because there was some Facebook posts that came out a couple weeks ago about what was being offered in elementary school, and I've asked Whitson's to change their menu online, because right now when you look at the menu online, you can only see a small snippet of what's being offered in our buildings, as opposed to other districts actually have all of the menu items that are being offered. So for example, if we always offer salads, that's not readily visible when you look at the menu off of our website. So they do have the nutritional content available. Off the top of my head, I don't know how to get to it, but it is there. I have seen it.
I'm going to tell you how to get to it. There is a section under, it looks like a fork and a knife on the website. If you click on that, you'll come to Ellenville Elementary and Ellenville Junior Senior High. If you click on the elementary, if you click on breakfast, you look at view menus, and you go in there, you can look at what's today.
22nd.
Today is the, so tomorrow is, I can't move this. So I'm gonna tell you that on Tuesday the 1st, there was an egg and cheese sandwich that was offered, and that had 456 calories, 7 grams of saturated fat, 264 milligrams of cholesterol. So the information is on the website. You just go to menus, you click on the menu, and there looks like a little green globe right there. And if you, I think it's a globe. If you click on that, it'll give you the nutritional value of each of the menus.
Thank you.
Yep.
How many grams of cholesterol?
I didn't say cholesterol, I said saturated fat.
Phew.
That's a lot.
Heart attack on a plate. All right, we'll move on to Deputy Superintendent Kelly White.
I don't have anything to report this evening.
Assistant Superintendent for Personnel and Curriculum, Mr. Scott Prokosh.
Good evening. Just an update to everyone. We have three current vacancies, two psychologists, one full-time psychologist position, 1.4 psychologist position, as well as a special education homebound half 0.5 position that we are continuing to post and try to find candidates for.
Thank you. Move on to personnel resolutions for this evening. 6.1, winter sports. Upon a recommendation, Superintendent of Schools, be it resolved that the following winter coaches be approved for the 24-25 school year as follows.
Move the list.
List has been moved. Second, discussion. Mr. Burns.
Can I just request that we get an updated roster list as we go along so that we don't have to make a decision on this without the final numbers?
We'll make sure you get that to the next pack.
Thank you.
Anybody else? If not, no further discussion. All those in favor? Opposed? No one? Motion carries. Substitute personnel, upon recommendation, Superintendent of Schools, be resolved the following substitute personnel be appointed through the 24-25 school year. Such appointments are contingent upon a district's receipt of fingerprint clearance from the New York State Education Department by no later than 45 days from date of hire.
Move the list.
List has been moved.
Second.
Second. Discussion. All those in favor? Opposed? No one. Motion carries. Security attendant, 6.3. Upon the recommendation superintendent of schools, be it resolved that Justin Ramirez be appointed a security attendant at a rate of $18.40 per hour work.
So moved.
Second.
And moved and seconded. Discussion. All those in favor? Opposed? No one. Motion carries. 6.4, co-curricular personnel. Upon the recommendation superintendent of schools, be resolved the co-curricular personnel is set forth in the attached list be approved at contractual rate 24-25 school year. Such appointments are contingent upon a district's receipt of fingerprint clearance from the New York State Education Department no later than 45 days from the date of hire. List has been moved.
Second.
Discussion. All those in favor? Opposed? No one. Motion carries. 6.5, disciplinary settlement. Be resolved the Board of Education in Ellenville Central School District that the disciplinary settlement with employee number 2005, a copy which shall be placed on file with the district clerk, is hereby approved.
So moved.
Been moved.
Second.
Discussion. All those in favor? Opposed? No one. Motion carries. 6.6, memorandum of agreement. Upon the recommendation superintendent of schools, be resolved the memorandum of agreement between the Ellenville Central School District and the ETSRPA teachers unit be approved as attached.
So moved.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Discussion. All those in favor? Opposed? No one. Motion carries. 6.7, intramural sports. Upon the recommendation superintendent of schools, be resolved the following individual be approved for intramural sports for the 24-25 school year at a rate of $47 per hour work, not to exceed 25 hours per sport.
Moved.
Been moved.
Second.
Discussion. Mr. Burns.
Yes, I'll just reaffirm my comments that I made in the past that I think if we're going to build numbers, we need to focus on the lower levels, especially a sport like wrestling. It's difficult to recruit kids in the high school ages that are new to the sport. So I'd like to ask that we get our athletic director to put more emphasis again on those lower levels. Thank you.
So noted. Any further discussion? If not, all those in favor? Opposed? No one. Motion carries. 6.8, permanent appointment. Upon a completion, a recommendation of superintendent of schools be resolved the appointment of Jessica Tazzo, registered nurse, be made permanent following successful probationary period effective November 3rd, 2024.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Discussion. All those in favor? Opposed? No one. Motion carries. 6.9, district clerk stipend. Be it resolved the Board of Education of Ellenville Central School District that Marisol Hemp shall receive a stipend in the amount of $10,000 for assuming additional duties during the absence of the secretary to the superintendent during 24-25. It's been moved. Seconded. Discussion. All those in favor? Opposed? No one. Motion carries. Policy resolutions for this evening. Somebody want to move that?
7-1.
It's been moved. Do we have a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? No one. Motion carries. Student IEPs for this evening.
Move 8-1 and 8-2.
It's been
second.
Moved. It's been moved and seconded. Discussion. All those in favor? Opposed? No one. Motion carries. Construction resolutions.
Motion move 9-1 and 9-5.
Second.
And moved and seconded. Discussion. All those in favor? Opposed? No one. Motion carries. Under other, under 10.1, resolved the Ellenville Central School District Board of Education cast their vote for John Burns for the position of New York State School Boards Association Area 9 Director.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Discussion. All those in favor? Opposed? No one. Motion carries. 10.2. Resolved the Board of Education in Ellenville Central School District approve the agreement with the State University of New York on behalf of SUNY Cortland.
So moved.
Moved second. And seconded. Discussion. All those in favor? Opposed? No one. Motion carries. 10.3, external audit. Resolved the attached external audit for the 23-24 school year be approved.
Move 10-3.
It's been moved.
Second.
Seconded. Discussion. All those in favor? Opposed? No one. Motion carries. Ladies and gentlemen, mark your calendars. The next meeting will be on Tuesday, November 12th. It's been next meeting is November 12th. And we're going to be looking at a date in November for our annual board administrators retreat. I'll be discussing that with the superintendent, coming up with some dates, and we'll get back to you on that. Entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Moved.
Second.
Seconded. All those in favor? Opposed? No one. Motion carries. We're adjourned.